But the fact that they could do that job and not having even met.
Well, I mean, like, people make albums. Bands make, you know, they don't, not even with the other guys.
Yeah.
It's crazy. I mean, I don't think people actually realize that.
No. Well, it's all the illusion, right?
Use your illusion.
We're not supposed to know anything. It's all...
Well, that's the problem with all this, you know, constant revelation about process and all that sort of stuff, is that people now are into the magic of the process, and they lose the magic of the product.
But I don't think they really understand the process either. That's the kind of the sad part for me, is that it's like they think they know the process, and they're still getting this kind of surface version of it.
Well, they get, and they get a hold of the buzzwords,
yeah,
you know, the pertinent words, and they throw them out, and then they attribute them to one person but not another, and you know, that's fun for them. you know, I do it in sports and business and all that, but I think if a true examination of the craft of acting and filmmaking, I think it's going to take a little longer.
Yeah. Well, everybody, I mean, we shoot a lot of these, and we shoot about 150 plus a year of half hours, and about 2/3 of them are probably actors, and everybody has similarities, but everybody has complete dissimilarities in terms of what they, how they work.
Yeah, the most important thing being that the end product is the character on film, you know, the author's intent, and no matter how you get there, that the point is to get there. And that was something that took me a few years to realize, was that I'm not a disciple of any particular method. You know, I've been taught several and employ many. But the point is to get the emotion or the reaction or whatever you want, and not try to do it a certain way, because some things don't work.
So did you stitch them together, or you just use what you need when you need it?
Well, you know, you develop a filing cabinet within you, and you know, you can, you know, go under this heading and grab this file and look at it and employ that file. And you're always looking for triggers. You know, if something works for you in the past, like, and I need it for this movie, then I just call it up, place it in there, smooth it around, dress it up like, that how I need to for this particular role, and use it, and they're all adaptable at the in the same way. You know, what do I need for, what works for me breaking down? What makes for, what works for love? What can I call up, and then, and by the time you're 20 years into the business or whatever it is, you have your triggers.
Are you all about what happens? Is the thing that you most love what happens on the stage, or is it what happens in the preparation, or where do you get your...
I love preparation. I love, you know, that makes it sound like I, you know, more, it is a science. Everything's a science. Everything can be broken down and put back together. But the end product is magic. So the science, it's like anything, you know, that's why you go to practice, and that's why you go to rehearsal, is to break it down so that when you're, when you put it back together, it becomes something greater than its parts. And it's exciting both ways. It's exciting to, you know, there was, I can't remember which painter said it, but he said the genius is in the choice. You know, it's not so much about it is the execution, but it's the choice. It's how did you come up with even that? How did you think of that? I mean, where did that come from? That's what the audience wants to know. I mean, if you are, if you give them a bit of a piece of behavior that they just, it's so natural, it just comes out of nowhere. Whoa, how did that happen? And you say, oh, it just happened. Well, that's not true. What happened was that you created it. And then they see the end result. It's like a magician. That's, I think that's acting at its best.
Are you a fan, are you a fan of certain kinds of acting? I mean, do you like the, are you interested in the people who are that kind of movie star, certain kind of rhythm person?
All I'm interested in is truth and honesty, and I don't care how it comes, but that is the requirement. I don't care if you, you know, have to sleep in a tent for this, that, the other, or if you have to, you know, I mean, You know, people need to research and they need to become very familiar with their subject, and then they need to personalize that subject. Mm-hmm. But how you do it is immaterial to me. Mm-hmm. If it means you have to write, you read, you live with, you know, all method is becoming personal with the material. Mm-hmm. That's all any of these things are. They're just different techniques of becoming personal and specific with the material. So however you can do that, however works best for you is the way to do it.
So when did you have your first thought of being an actor?
I did my first play when I was 14. I was mm-hmm. in high school. I was going to a school in England, and I was going to rugby practice, and there was a sign or something up in the cafeteria that said auditions for Charlie Brown, the doctor is in. Mm-hmm. And for some reason I went to the audition, and I was the only candidate for Charlie Brown, and thus I got Charlie Brown. And it was a turning point in my life. Mm-hmm. Never been on stage before. My mother's a writer, she's an artist. Her mother was an artist. So I felt it must have come from somewhere. Mm-hmm. And then after that I did another play, and then after that I...
So was it the audience that you got you there, or was it losing yourself? Or
it's not the audience. I like the audience, but that's not the thrill for me. The thrill is...
Well, I just mean in Charlie Brown.
Oh, no. But in general, it's the ability to create real feelings under make-believe circumstances. Hmm. The energy that you can create that feels real, mm-hmm. but isn't, is magical to me. Like when I'm acting, if you and I are listening to each other right now, mm-hmm. we're serving a purpose to each other and all this, and we have energy flowing between us, it's a perfect moment. If you filmed this, it would be perfect, mm-hmm. and it would be interesting, and we are filming it. And but if then you tried to recreate that in a film, the problem with recreation in a film is that you have all these other psychosis to deal with, and then a mm-hmm. crew and all this, and a script and all that, so it becomes harder. And the challenge is to take all these unnatural elements mm-hmm. and this unnatural environment and make it real. And that to me is it's my mission in life.
And do you feel it when it happens on that set?
Yes, but it doesn't happen all the time. Mm-hmm. You know, sometimes the other actor will be glassy-eyed, or mm-hmm. They're not there, or they don't know what they're doing, or I don't know what I'm doing. You know, something's always happening where it impedes right. this purity. Mm-hmm. That's why when you see somebody who is able to, let's say, you know, a slugger who can hit, you know, 300, right? Mm-hmm. It's the same thing in the movies, you know. A guy who can come up with that energy 300, a third of the time, mm-hmm. is a hero. And then kind of get you through the rest of it. But when you feel it, you know it. And it's exciting. Yeah. And you can see everybody around you gets excited about it.
I always think it only takes a few moments in a film to make the difference between a film that people adore and love. And, you know, there can be all kinds of other problems, and it just doesn't matter because those few moments are so powerful that they go back and back and back.
That's exactly right. If you can point to two or three moments in a film that impact you, you're always going to speak positively of that movie. Yeah. But those three moments are hard to come by because, first of all, they have to be in the writing. Mm-hmm. Then they have to, you know, everything has to gel. Mm-hmm. But it's intoxicating. You know, it's like surfing. You know, I grew up surfing. It's mm-hmm. like, what's this idea of the perfect wave? You know, everybody's looking for this perfect wave. Mm-hmm. Well, it's true, man, because when you get on a wave, feels good. Mm-hmm. Feels something like you don't feel every day, and you're working the wave, and you're, it's just a terrific feeling.
So do you have that urge to go to the extreme waves?
And to, well, you know, be towed out. Extreme. No. I don't like big waves and stuff like that. I used to surf. I surfed, did Hawaii and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. But no, it's more the shape of the wave. Mm-hmm. It's more of the it's just being able to look at the wave and to digest it and to judge it and to see how I'm going to move on that wave, mm-hmm. where that ride's going to take me. And usually it's a disappointment. You know, it closed out, or I caught a rail, or some mm-hmm. other guy got it, or whatever it is, you know, but I got just enough mm-hmm. to keep me from paddling in and paddle back out.
So a smaller wave can be as exhilarating as a big one.
Totally. Absolutely.
So is it harder to surf a big movie than a movie as intimate as this one?
Well, this has, if you're talking about pure performance, this has more things going for it because it has, a Tony Award-winning script, Pulitzer Prize-winning writer, has Oscar winners in it. It is developed for the express purpose of nurturing performance mm-hmm. And the story. It's not, it has people who, around it, who love film mm-hmm. and who are interested in making a good movie as opposed to making money. So that sort of thing is attractive to me, mm-hmm. but a big movie is attractive too because you have different problems. But you know, you want people to see your movie. Mm-hmm. That's all there is to it. You work so hard, you care so much about it that if you know, it's good to say, yeah, I made this movie, it was great, but like you know, 10 people saw it.
Yeah.
As opposed to, it really got out there. It made an impact. People talk to you about it on the street. It's mm-hmm. fun. You know, that's intoxicating too.
So something like Thank You for Smoking.
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
Absolutely unbelievable. Young and old, every day. The problem is with Thank You for Smoking is they always say Thank You for Not Smoking.
Mm-hmm.
But that movie has impacted so many people. Or Aaron Brockovich, or The Dark Knight, or mm-hmm. In the Company of Men. My first movie that I ever did was like, I had somebody come up to me the other day, you know, and any time where they're using their five senses when they're talking about your movie, you know, they're like, their hands are contracting, and their faces, and they're lighting up, you know, you're like, it worked.
Right.
But, interestingly enough, somebody will come up to you and go, this movie, and you're like, really? I just try to forget about that movie. You know what I mean? I really like that movie. Mm-hmm. And then I have to step back and go, accept it. Mm-hmm. And go, I'm glad you like that movie. Because maybe I didn't like it. It's not a perfect movie, but mm-hmm. I'm glad that, you know, some people say a movie, I saw this movie 3 times. I bought the DVD. And it's just so surprising to me.
Mm. Well, so when Company of Men happened, it was this. It was a bigger success, I think, almost in the industry than it was, you know, for critics and for people who are past cinephiles, really, as well. And then it was huge audience necessarily immediately. Of course, it's played a lot since then. But you were a very, very specific character. It was a very, very intense performance. Were you typed at that point? Were you concerned about being typed?
No, I was concerned about getting a job. First of all, the movie was never. I mean, who were we? I was some guy in a 10 by 12 apartment in New York City, you know, going to my restaurant job and trying to get an agent. And Neil was living in the Midwest, working at a psychiatric hospital at night. So we were as surprised as anybody about the reaction. But when it did come out, my life changed.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I was literally went from couldn't get a job mm-hmm. to Sean Penn calling me on the phone personally saying I just watched your movie and I loved it. You know, every single day after The Company of Men for the last 12 years, every single day something insane has happened in my life. Like any person who wasn't in this business or whatever would be just like, that's incredible, mm-hmm. you know, and it's been a wonderful 12 years.
Did you pick roles after that with the intention, or did you really have a chance to pick roles for a while, or?
Yeah, I what I did right after that was I tried to go against the role, mm-hmm. against, I think what the natural progression for a young actor would have been was like jump into a romantic comedy or try to make the most of it in terms of, you know, getting the most jack out of Hollywood. Yeah.
Well, when this town sees a leading man, they jump all over that. Then.
Yeah, but the problem is that leading man, and it bears fruit, that leading men usually aren't ready for Hollywood. They need time to ripen.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why so many fall off the tree and just, you know, die on the ground. You need time to get to know who you are,
mm-hmm.
you know, to flex your muscles and say, get to, you know, That's why I did Your Friends and Neighbors right afterwards. And then I did a couple movies that weren't so great, that didn't work, but I was trying to find a follow a model that wasn't natural to me. Mm-hmm. I started to run with the Hollywood paradigm instead of my own. And it's only when I've gotten back to what I believe in or what I feel is natural for me that I've had success. Like Thank You, Conversations with Other Women, which was a personal success for me. This movie and things like that. Like, otherwise, you know, you feel like you don't know why you're acting. You're acting for somebody else. You're acting to get somewhere instead of being here and this being the point, this movie being the point of my existence, as opposed to I'm going to do this movie so it can get me this movie. Mm-hmm. That usually doesn't work. And that's why you see young actors hit, struggle, get to know who they are down here, go through the fire, and then if they have talent and have the it factor or whatever, they shoot back up. If not, they go like that.
Or they take one or two movies that aren't working, they have it, and they still can't get anywhere because it's...
Well, that's what I mean.
The system just doesn't want to take a chance again.
Yeah, I mean, if you get here for one reason, the problem a lot of the times is that the actor doesn't know why he's hit, you know, and so he doesn't know what to rely on. Mm-hmm. And he doesn't know where to go to, or she. Those that are smart at a young age and do hit, like DiCaprio, or, you know, look at between, like, guys who can handle it and can't, DiCaprio or Ed Furlong, you know, went a different direction, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But had the same success, huge success.
Yeah.
But this business is, in terms of, you know, you have to know who you are in this business.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, it's interesting watching some of them because you... Every once in a while somebody shows up and you go, that guy's a movie star, and then they just doesn't, it's almost like they don't want to go there sometimes.
They
like
don't. They don't because they don't trust it. Because the what happens is after you hit, then Hollywood tells you, you have to do this, you have to do this, you have to do this. Mm-hmm. And you're saying, yeah, but I want to do this. I instinctually feel like doing this. But everybody's mesmerized by this, the oasis of success. Mm-hmm. And you know, maybe if people stuck to their instincts and trusted themselves and took the longer route, they'd still go to the oasis.
Right.
But they'd take a different direction and they wouldn't be as famous so quick and they wouldn't be as rich so quick, but they would have a foundation to fall back on tough times.
So what is your relationship with directors as you move along? I mean, you started with Neil, but you've worked with some of the big ones and worked with some of, you know, first timers along the way.
Yeah. I think directors are the most important thing on the movie. There's just, hands down, they are the movie. Mm-hmm. And a good director is worth his weight. Mm-hmm. And there's nothing that can compare to experience. And even though, you know, a director might be a writer or he might be a DP or whatever it is, I'm at the point in my life where it takes a special person like Jason Reitman to continually hit it out of the park, to have a concept and to employ that concept and make it work. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you know, I'd go with experience all the time. But I love good, hungry directors that push their cast, that demand something of out of performance, who know how to talk to actors, who allow actors to talk to them and have their own ideas. That's why it's interesting to work with actor directors like John Cameron Mitchell, because John is an actor and he's sensitive and he understands and, you know, because actors can look at the set and go, I know that we need to move on. I understand that the sun is setting. I understand that there's only 200 feet in the can. I understand that we're out of time. But I need to do this. So, you know, you need to come to some sort of arrangement with the director where he needs to be able to push you along and say, we're moving on. And for the actor to trust that and feel like he's done his best work.
So when you are approached on a film like this, I assume you got the script first?
No. I got a call from Nicole first. And saying, you know, would you be interested? Call. And would you read the script? Call. I believe that was how it happened. It all happened around the same time. And I got a call from John. I had a couple calls with John. I was making The Rum Diary, with down in Puerto Rico, mm-hmm. and didn't have a lot of time for this sort of stuff, and didn't have face-to-face discussions. It's mm-hmm. all done on the telephone and through agents. But there were a few factors in this movie for me. One was Nicole, which I thought, doing a movie, I'm married to Nicole, and our son has died. What a great challenge. And then I read the script, and I have a lot to do in this movie, and my character is important to the film. Mm-hmm. And so I jumped at it. I didn't have enough time for it. I could have, you know, there were reasons not to do the movie, right. but I just felt like working with Nicole was, and then John was mm-hmm. too big of a deal.
So what did you hear from John that made you go, he's the guy I want to work with?
Well, so it's what you hear and what you don't hear. John, what I heard, I'll tell you, to any actor, is John wanted to include me in the project. I was important to him mm-hmm. and important to the movie, and that was important to me because I felt like I could trust him, or I could begin to trust him. Mm-hmm. He would allow me to be me, and what was important with Nicole was that she would allow me to be me. You know, I've worked with a lot of big girls, and the most important thing is that we collaborate, that it's mm-hmm. not a dictatorship. And I wouldn't work like that. If I felt like I were walking into a tyrannical mm-hmm. set, I just wouldn't be a part of it. And so on the phone, you know, Nicole really impressed on me that it was a married couple. Mm-hmm. It's clearly her film.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, you're kind of the ginger to her Fred. I mean, you are, the couple is critically important that the two of them are doing the dance together.
Absolutely.
But you're kind of catching a lot of it.
I'm a supporter. My character and all the characters in this film define the protagonist, and that is Nicole. Mm-hmm. There's no illusion about that. Now, I'm not saying that, I'm not trying to diminish my role or my importance in the right. film. What I'm saying is I know walking into this that what my role is, and that is to push this forward, the story forward in the correct way. But no matter, look at Diane Wiest, look at Tammy, look at Miles. Mm-hmm. We're all important characters. We all have a role to play. But we all need to go into it saying, this movie is about my character, because mm-hmm. you're going to get a better movie. But knowing in the back of our heads that we're supporting Nicole's character. Mm-hmm. You know, it makes a good relationship that way. So, and for Nicole to be able to open up her arms to all of us and accept us and say, you know, this is a group thing.
One of the things about your character is that he is going through so many of these things and doing the male things of not showing and not doing the male things, because he is showing in certain ways. And there is a degree of testosterone that that seems to be inherent in this character.
It has to be.
But then he also gives it up.
But it's there. That's the important thing, because you can't emasculate this character. And that was the one thing that I was very cognizant of. I'm not going to come in here and play mm-hmm. the puppet here. I'm not going to play a puppy dog. And yes, my character is restrained, but he is a full person with thoughts and loves and hates and anger and all the five senses. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to demonstrate those in this film. And the male audience, or the audience in general, needs my character, Howie, to push her and say, no, or you're wrong, mm-hmm. or you're being difficult, and then retreat. It's okay to retreat, mm-hmm. But it's I have to push those buttons for the film, and that's necessary. And then, so the audience goes, okay, this is a real relationship here.
Yeah. And for her character, I mean,
totally.
You question whether her character makes any of this progress without Howie pushing, and she doesn't go the way you want her to go, or Howie wants her to go all the time, but she goes somewhere.
But what if she didn't want to go to group and all that sort of stuff, and Howie just said, okay, darling, you know, I'm okay with that. That doesn't make an interesting movie, and it doesn't mm-hmm. it doesn't create respect. And these characters need to be respected. You know, when there's that scene when I accuse her of erasing my son Danny's our son Danny's picture. You know, mm-hmm. that's necessary because if your character's so restrained the whole time, the audience is going to be sitting there going, why doesn't he yell at her? Why doesn't he stick up for himself, you know? Mm-hmm. And when they do, the audience gets to live through Howie in that moment, say, ah, now we can build back up and, mm-hmm. you know, come back, you know, so you're creating that music.
So John's great choice in that, I think, was putting you in front of the refrigerator for so long,
yeah.
looking at the emptiness
yeah.
that's been gone.
And her, too, you know, yeah. her doing the wash and you know, it's a house, it's a family of three that becomes two,
mm-hmm.
but the third is always there. So it's a house, it's a haunted house. It's a house of three that's two. Mm-hmm. So something's always missing. So no matter where you go, you're traumatized by this experience. And you can never escape,
mm-hmm.
no matter where you go. And that's the great thing about the film, too, because you can't escape loss. Yeah. You have to deal with it.
But Howie doesn't necessarily want to escape.
Howie doesn't.
Yeah.
But even Becca can't.
Yeah.
You can't escape.
Or you can't, but... He doesn't, his choice of how to handle his grief in part seems to be wanting to let it exist for him in a very
yeah.
clear way.
Yeah, I think, I don't want to say mature because grief is irrational, I guess, or illogical. So they're grieving at different speeds in different ways. But, you know, Howie seems to be the more mature mm-hmm. of the two in this instance. But then again, you just lost your son. So what does maturity have to do with it?
Yeah.
You know, everybody says, okay, take a month and then get on with your life. Well, in my experience and research, that just is not the way it goes.
But it's an endlessly fascinating thing about how people, you just never know how people are going to react to any of it. Even the loss of an 80-year-old, 90-year-old mother can have this profound effect, and you think, you know, you knew she was going.
Right.
It wasn't that shocking, and yet your entire life has changed, and to lose a small child is...
Well, you because know. I think it goes beyond the mind, and it goes to the physical, of the energy and the spirit of if it's an appendage, it's a part of you, and if it's ripped away, then what are you supposed to do now?
Yeah.
You go to it, but it's not there. And so it's always missing. And, you know, that feeling of homesickness or whatever it is, it's like your home's not here, but you feel it here.
Mm-hmm.
And it was good, though, because we always kept Danny close to us. We filmed the movie in the house. We basically were in the house the whole time,
mm-hmm.
Around his bedroom and around the pictures and all that sort of stuff. So he was definitely a part of the movie.
Do you look back much?
Yeah.
Absolutely. Do you watch your work? Do you
No.
watch work you did?
No.
Do you watch it ever?
No. But I
Have
should.
Have you watched this film? Have you seen this movie?
No.
Huh.
I should. I would be a better actor if I did. You know, it's like a football player watching tape on Monday.
But the fact that you've chosen not to probably speaks to the fact that maybe you wouldn't be. Maybe you know somewhere that it's a good thing to do it this way.
Well, I know I wouldn't be satisfied. I'm very hard on myself, and it would be an uncomfortable. But I do have regrets for sure. You know, I like to make good films and feel like I'm good in them,
mm-hmm.
and I always want to do better work.
Do you give any play to the awards stuff, or is that? I mean, obviously, it's nice to be honored, but.
I always find a way to talk my way out of it, of saying, you know, oh, it's because that guy, blah, you know, I don't know.
Well, Brockovich is still strange to me because your performance was so critical to the movie, and I think in some ways because you were so human and so not a big character, I guess. I mean, Albert had more to play and Julia had more to play, and I think that you didn't get your... come up and
but it's really the same. It's kind of the same thing in this movie, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You have a job to do, and your job or my job is to support the protagonist, and that mm-hmm. was Julia, clearly, and I'm happy to do it, and Nicole, and hopefully when you know I'm in that position, then the people do it for me.
Better to get it now that you've been around for a while and you're...
I feel like I'm happy to do the work that I've done. I've worked with incredible people. I'm excited to do better work and to do more films. I'm always looking to do better work.
Yeah. Well, you're one of those actors who, you know, it feels like every year you could be nominated because you're just always doing tremendous work. So
well, and I think if anybody, you know, we talked about this a little bit today, was you know, if you're not a sore thumb, or if people say, yeah, the movie was good except for that, for Aaron, mm-hmm. then I think it's okay. But I'd like for people to, you know, really have an experience with my characters and with the film, and to really feel like they've gotten something out of it.
I think you've made that happen.